Cinco de Mayo is one of the most celebrated Latino festivities in the United States, and at the same time, not well known what in that date of May 5 of 1862 happened. I think it is necessary to have a quick view of the historical events of that time in Mexico. Between the years 1858 and 1860, Mexico suffered a civil war between liberals and conservatives, known as the War of Reform. The President Benito Juarez, in 1861, became president of the bankrupted nation. The president needed to come up with means of paying the government employees and the soldiers, and at the same time also had to satisfy grievances presented by Spain, Great Britain, and France. Benito Juarez was willing to make the payments demanded, but the precarious economy faced at that time forced the Mexican government to suspend the payment of the foreign debts for 2 years. In October 1861, diplomats from Spain, France, and Britain met in London to form an alliance with the primary purpose of launching an invasion of Mexico to control Veracruz, Mexican principal port, and forcing the Mexico to negotiate terms for repaying its debts and for reparations of alleged harm to foreign citizens during the Civil War. This meeting is known as the Convention of London, that was in violation of the Monroe Doctrine, whose main intent was European, not intervention in the Americas, but at the time, the United States was not able to offer opposition due to the Civil War. In December 1861, Spanish troops landed in Veracruz. British and French followed in January. The Mexican government sent to Veracruz Manuel Doblado, who was at the time the Secretary of Foreign Affairs. General Doblado noticed that the coalition had some disagreements between them and used those in his advantage. General Doblado signed on February 22 a preliminary agreement to begin negotiations known as the Treaty of La Soledad. In this treaty, the government allowed the armies of the alliance to occupy Tehuacan, Orizaba, and Cordoba, away from the coast where yellow fever was prevalent. The agreement of La Soledad has a condition that, in case of failure of the negotiations, the foreign troops must return to Paso Ancho and Paso Ovejas, their original places of encampment, before reinitiating military action. Because of this agreement, the Spanish troops occupied Cordoba and Orizaba. The French troops went to Tehuacan, and the British stayed in their ships. Mexican army, who was already advancing toward Veracruz to engage the invaders, stopped the advance and moved back to San Andrés Chalchicomula to comply with the agreement of La Soledad, where the Mexican army had storage of arms, gunpowder, and ammunition. There was an accidental blaze in the scullery that spread to the armory, producing an explosion, killing 1,042 soldiers, 475 women, 200 soldiers were injured, and 500 civilians, residents of San Andrés and Chalchicomula. Parallel to the Reform War, an arrival to Veracruz of the foreign Allied troops in Europe, José María Gutiérrez Estrada was a man on a mission to bring a monarch to rule Mexico. Estrada was 21 years old when Agustín de Iturbide established Mexican independence and not as a republic but as a monarchy, assuming himself the short-lived imperial throne of Mexico, ending 2 years after the coronation, when Agustín de Iturbide was deposed and later executed by fire squad. 40 years after the independence of Mexico, still convulsed. Gutiérrez Estrada spent a big part of his life in Europe as a Mexican ambassador in Vienna and Rome, with a short period in Mexico. in charge of the Office of Foreign Affairs. Gutiérrez Estrada was obsessed to bring a monarch to Mexico as the way to end the instability of the country. For many years, Gutiérrez Estrada worked to get the support of these monarchist ideas in Europe. He spoke unsuccessfully with Prince Metternich, Lord Palmerston, with exiled King Louis, but things changed when Napoleon III viewed the opportunity of establishing a French-controlled government in America to diminish the power the United States was acquiring. At the time, there was another Mexican diplomat, José Hidalgo, with secure connections with the Spanish court, and in France, thanks to the friendship with the Spanish aristocrat, Eugenia de Montijo, who was the wife of Napoleon III, Emperor of France. Hidalgo's properties in Mexico has been confiscated by the liberal government, for which reason he was very enthusiastic for a conservative restoration of power. He saw the opportunity to recover his properties and continue living in Europe with the revenues derived from them. With the help of Eugenia de Montijo, José Hidalgo met with Napoleon, introducing him to some Mexican refugees who had good reason to wish Juárez to be deposed as the president of Mexico. The conservatives found an influential ally in the Duke of Morny, who entered in partnership with the firm Jecker and Company, who in return for political support had promised him 30% of the recovery of the Mexican debt had with that company. Jecker lent to the Mexican government before Juárez became president 15 million pesos in bonds, 619,000 pesos in cash, 368,000 pesos in military clothing. Napoleon III developed a plan to vindicate the principle of monarchy against liberalism for the conservation of the Latin civilization. He envisioned to regenerate Mexico by the hand of a Catholic sovereign, supported by French army, with the mission of building a great Latin empire stretching from Mexico to Panama. The French ambassador in Mexico, Dubois de Saligny, was utilized by the Duke of Morny, and what was told by the exiled Mexicans in Paris, Napoleon was convinced that a French army to liberate Mexico from a corrupted government would be welcome the Mexicans. After the Allied forces arrived in Mexican soil, England and Spain realized that France trying to utilize them to violate the Mexican sovereignty. England and Spain went to Mexico to collect a debt, not to make a war on Mexico or to depose the Mexican government, as was keeping clear to Manuel Doblado by the Spaniard General Prim. France increased the military presence in Mexico. A new army arrived to Veracruz under the command of General Lorenzé, and with him the Mexican conservative General Almonte, who assumed the title of Provisional President of Mexico. Under these circumstances, Spain and England decided to leave as France prepared for a march on Mexico City in violation of the Treaty of La Soledad and in defiance with the warning made by Lincoln to the alliance. The warning made by the President of the United States was taken seriously by Spain and England, but Napoleon was hoping for a Confederate victory in the American Civil War. Now I want to read you the note President Lincoln sent. A foreign monarchy set up in Mexican soil in the presence of European naval and military forces would be an insult to the Republican form of government, which is the most widely spread at the American continent, and would mean the beginning rather the end of revolution in Mexico. The sympathies of the United States would be on the side of her sister republic for the liberation of the continent from the European control has been leading feature of the American history in the past century. So according to King Leopold, that note was largely what make to make England not be that enthusiastic, we continue being there. Continue being part of the alliances. So when becoming evident to Spain and in England that France was committed to installing a monarchy in Mexico, they retired, breaking apart the tripartite alliance. On April 29, the French army occupied Amozoc. After ferocious battle, engaging the troops under the command of General Porfirio Díaz. The chief general, Ignacio Zaragoza, gives the order to General Negrete to occupy the hills of Guadalupe and Loreto. General Porfirio Díaz wrote in his memoirs how General Ignacio Zaragoza called for a meeting to the generals Ignacio Mejía, Miguel Negrete, Antonio Álvarez, Francisco Lamadrid, Felipe Berriozábal, and Porfirio Díaz. In that meeting, General Zaragoza told them how insignificant was so far the resistance presented during the advancement of the French troops for a nation around 8 million people at the time. General Zaragoza said to them, "Was unacceptable that the French end in Mexico City with not presenting the resistance expected by a great nation. He demanded from all of us," said General Diaz, "to promise that we are going to fight to the ultimate consequences in the way that if we could not reach victory, we will present the resistance expected from us by the nation." Victory was not very logic aspiration, continues saying General Diaz in his memoirs. "The disadvantages when compared with the French army, the most powerful of the world, are evident not only in warfare quality, but in the discipline due to the high quality of military training in France." It's interesting to read the General Porfirio Diaz details of the Battle of Puebla, but in summary, what happened was at 9 a.m. on May 5, as the French troops advanced toward Puebla, Ignacio Zaragoza anticipated the intention of the enemy when we saw the glare of the French arms in the summit of the hill named Navajas. The French were preparing to attack the mountains of Loreto and Guadalupe. General Zaragoza commands the brigades of Caballería of General Berriozábal and La Madrid to go to the top of the hills for reinforcement of the troops already there. The fortification of Guadalupe could be taken by the French, but the forces of General Berriozábal, and for the movement of that battalions, Reforma and San Luis, who fight body to body with bayonets, making the French to retrocede when the small pieces of artillery that were distributed between the infantry soldiers per order of General Zaragoza spat fire against the invaders with the triumph of the battle to the Mexican army. General Zaragoza, the hero of the Battle of Puebla, passed away 1 week later, infected with typhoid. Despite the heroism of the Mexican soldiers, Napoleon III established the Second Mexican Empire with Maximilian and Carlota from 1864 to 1867. A Mexican Empire is worth to have another program dedicated to it. Today I'm going to introduce you a Mexican poet that is, he lived on the time of this history of Maximilian and Carlota. And the poet is Manuel Acuña, and have several poems. The well-known poem is Nocturno a Rosario. So I'm going to read it to you and you will see the translation in English. Nocturno a Rosario, de Manuel Acuña. Pues bien, yo necesito decirte que te quiero, decirte que te adoro con todo el corazón, que es mucho lo que sufro, que es mucho lo que lloro, que ya no puedo tanto y al grito que te imploro y te hablo en nombre de mi última ilusión. Yo quiero que tú sepas que ya hace muchos días estoy enfermo y pálido de tanto no dormir, que ya se han muerto todas las esperanzas mías, que están mis noches negras, tan negras y sombrías, que ya no sé ni dónde se alza el porvenir. De noche cuando pongo mis sienes en la almohada y hacia otro mundo quiero mi espíritu volver, camino mucho, mucho, y al fin de la jornada las formas de mi madre se pierden en la nada y tú de nuevo vuelves en mi alma a aparecer. Comprendo que tus besos jamás han de ser míos. Comprendo que en tus ojos no me he de ver jamás y te amo y en mis locos y ardientes desvaríos bendigo tus desdenes, adoro tus desvíos y en vez de amarte menos, te quiero mucho más. A veces pienso en darte mi eterna despedida, borrarte en mis recuerdos y huir de esta pasión, mas si es en vano todo y mi alma no te olvida, ¿qué quieres tú que yo haga pedazo de mi vida? ¿Qué quieres tú que yo haga con este corazón? Y luego que ya estaba concluido el santuario, la lámpara encendida, tu velo en el altar, el sol de la mañana detrás del campanario, chispeando las antorchas, humeando el incensario, y abierto allá a lo lejos la puerta del hogar. Qué hermoso hubiera sido vivir bajo aquel techo, los dos unidos siempre, llamándonos los dos. Tú siempre enamorada, yo siempre satisfecho, los dos un alma sola, los dos un solo pecho, y en medio de nosotros mi madre como un Dios. Figúrate qué hermosas las horas de la vida, qué dulce y bello el viaje por una tierra así, y yo soñaba en eso mi santa prometida, y al delirar en eso, con alma estremecida, pensaba yo en ser bueno por ti, no más por ti. Bien sabe Dios que ese era mi más hermoso sueño, mi afán y mi esperanza, mi dicha y mi placer. Bien sabe Dios que nada cifraba yo mi empeño, sino en amarte mucho, en el hogar risueño que me envolvió en sus besos cuando me vio nacer. Esa era mi esperanza, mas ya que a sus fulgores sopone el hondo abismo que existe entre los dos. Adiós por la última vez, amor de mis amores, la luz de mis tinieblas, la esencia de mis flores, mi lira de poeta, mi juventud, adiós. Beautiful poem, beautiful poem. There is Manuel Acuña, born on August 1849 and died on December 1873. Was a 19th century, one of the most important 19th century writers of Mexico. Also, at his time, was another extraordinary poet. Pesa was a very good poet too at the time. He was was already very famous poet, Manuel Acuña, and he was medical student. And probably because that impossible love that is telling in that Nocturna Rosario, he ended taking his own life when he was just 27 years old. Also today, I want to recommend you a book. This book is a History of Mexico. It's an excellent book. That is a History of Mexico. Is the I have here with me the third edition. That is the writer is Henry Bamford Parks. He is a very good writer. He did a lot of research to make this book, and it's very easy to read. And so I really recommend you to read this book. Again, it's a History of Mexico by Henry Bamford Parks. Thank you very much for having me with you today again, and I hope you like the program. Please give us your feedback. And I want to remind you that every fourth Thursday of the month, I will be at the Hudson Public Library. I will be speaking in Spanish with anybody that want to go there. We are going to talk about everything, so it's not a limit. So that is bilingual conversations. The idea is for the people who wants to start studying Spanish, students or people who doesn't have too much opportunity to speak Spanish, there could be there, and I will looking forward to meet all of you. And thank you for having me again on your home today. Thank you. Thank you.